iOS 26 was just released, but I don't want to focus on the big features everyone's already been talking about, like call screening or message backgrounds or even live translation. Instead, I want to focus on features that are more hidden, meaning they're not even mentioned anywhere in Apple's supposed list of all new features that they publish as a PDF. I'm Theojo, and let's get into it. Starting off, there's a new wired accessories menu in the privacy and security settings that allows you to basically choose how it allows different USB devices to connect when you plug them in, like always allow or allow when unlocked, and I personally have it set to ask for new accessories. Next, under general and then AirPlay and continuity, there's a new setting called keep audio with headphones, and like the name describes, it makes it so if you switch Apple devices, it's going to make sure the audio comes from the one that you're actually using. When customizing the lock screen, you can now swipe down on the widgets bar and move the widgets to the bottom position, not just at the top like usual. One improvement that you might not notice is that screen recordings on your phone are now higher resolution. For example, on my iPhone 16 Pro, before the screen recordings were 884 by 1920, but now they're 1206 by 2622, the full resolution of the actual screen. So they're no longer downscaled. And screenshots, by the way, are the same. They were always the full resolution. Speaking of screen recordings, there's a new screen capture menu in the general settings, and there's several options in here. The full screen previews is for when you're taking a screenshot. It lets you select whether you want to go directly to the full screen preview without having to tap the little preview in the corner. However, this would make it harder if you want to take multiple screenshots quickly. There's also an option for whether you want to capture screenshots and screen recordings in HDR. And if you use CarPlay, there's now an option to make it so it doesn't capture a screenshot of the CarPlay screen as well when you take a screenshot. You might not have liked that. Also, related to screenshots, when you're doing markup, there's a new tool called Add Loop, which basically is like a little zoom in circle thing that you can now add. Next, a little thing I noticed in the Passwords app under a Wi-Fi network, it'll now show the security connection type, for example, WPA3 or WPA2, for whatever that one used. Another kind of random one is in the About for the phone. If you long press on the IMEI ID for your phone, you now have an option to share device identifiers, and then it'll actually have the ability to share to another phone via NFC, and you just tap it to your other phone, it'll kind of share it. Not sure where you would need that, but it's possible now. Here's a really useful one in messages. If you now go to the little info thing at the top for whatever conversation, and then go to the photos tab, like before, you can see the images from that conversation, but what's new is you can long press on one of them and then have the option to show in conversation, and it will jump to that location wherever that photo was used, so you can remember the context of it. Next, here's a bunch of hidden changes for the phone app specifically. The first one I can't really show you, but basically when you call someone, when they answer or if it goes to voicemail, there will now be a haptic feedback, kind of like a quick vibration, so you can know that they picked up and it stopped ringing. Next up, if you go to the info page for a particular person or caller, you are now able to see the actual full call history between that person and also voicemails, whereas before I think it would only show you a few of the more recent calls. Next, there's a few new options actually when you swipe on a recent call. Instead of just having the option to delete, you'll see one option, for example, to add a reminder with this blue clock, and then you can add 1 hour or whatever. And if you're using the new unified view for calls, those reminders will actually show at the top of the list. And you may also see this option with the orange hand, which will let you either block or block and report spam on the call. And I say you may see it because it apparently depends on your carrier. It might not always show up. Next, for those of you using dual SIM, you're gonna like this. Now, anytime you tap on a number anywhere on the phone, it'll actually give you the option for which line to use to make that call instead of always just using the default line. All right, moving on, here's some hidden features specific to the Wallet app. For certain third-party accounts and cards, you can now actually see details about individual transactions. Before, I believe that was only for the Apple Card. And speaking of Apple Card, for transactions through that, if you need to now change the category of a transaction, you can do that now. Next up, this one could come in handy, and that is you can now save and view the actual card number of a card you've added to the wallet. What you do is click this little button at the top and then hit add physical card information. And then from now on, you can see that information, and it clarifies that it won't use that card number for actual Apple Pay payments. However, you can still view it and it'll still use it for autofill, like if a website doesn't support Apple Pay. Another little thing is you can now actually search in the wallet for both cards that you've added or cards that are possible to add that you haven't yet. So it saves you from having to look through the whole list. All right, moving on, here's a few random UI changes that aren't really features, but I thought they were worth mentioning. If you happen to have multiple language keyboards set, it will now actually show which language you're using on the spacebar. Before, it would only do this if you had set a bilingual keyboard, but now it does it for everything. And this one is really good to know, and that is when swiping back from a menu, you don't have to put your finger all the way on the left side to start that swipe back. You can do it, for example, from the middle or whatever. And this does seem to apply system-wide to all apps, though I did notice if a particular app has a hitbox for a region to do something else, like in this Reddit app, you can swipe to save a post or comment, that will still take priority, but otherwise you don't have to swipe all the way from the left to go back. By the way, if you're enjoying the video so far, I'd appreciate it if you lightly tap the like button. It really helps with the algorithm. All right, now let's go over some cool but less promoted features that I found while digging through that big change log of the features, but they're not mentioned on the main big features page. First of all, blocked contacts got pretty much a UI overhaul. For example, now in your contacts list, it'll clearly show a symbol next to blocked contacts, and it'll also show this in messages and even as a label on that particular person's contact page. It's not just purely visual though. For example, you can now no longer send a message to a blocked contact. The message box just isn't there. I assume people were forgetting that they had blocked someone and then were confused when they didn't get a response. However, one exception is if you're in a group chat with someone that you've blocked, it will still go to everyone in the group chat, including the person you blocked. If you need to see a full list of all the people you've blocked, even if they're not contacts, that list will now show under privacy and security and then blocked contacts. All right, moving on. There are now new ways you can customize that vehicle motion cues feature that was added in iOS 18. If you go into the settings, there's a new customize appearance menu for it where you can change the appearance like a regular or dynamic mode for like how they look, as well as the color, and have larger or just more dots. So if you use that feature, it might be worth taking a look at. Here's a pretty useful one. You can now actually change to use a specific microphone input. You can customize this under a new menu under sound and haptics and then input. And it seems to default to automatic, but you can also set a specific one. And you can see that if you, for example, have headphones connected, you can have an option to use the headphones there or the phone. And you can apparently also change the input just for a specific app. If the microphone is active from an app, you should see a orange status thing at the top. And if you tap on that from the control center, you can then select the microphone to use just for that app, where it would default to same as input that you set in the global menu, or you can choose a specific one. One accessibility feature that's been improved is the create personal voice feature. It now only requires 10 vocal samples where you record yourself saying something, whereas before it would require 150 samples. That's the feature that basically creates a clone of your voice to use for different stuff. I've never actually used it myself, but it's a lot easier, so it might be worth looking into. Next up, if you go into the battery settings, you'll find a new adaptive power mode option. I believe this is turned off by default, but if you turn it on, the iPhone will basically detect when you're using more battery than usual and sort of do a halfway between low power mode, where it will reduce some processing stuff so that it uses less energy, but not to the full extent of going into power saving. And I would probably turn on the notifications for when it activates this to get a better idea of when it actually turns it on. All right, moving on, here's some lesser promoted features for messages specifically. First up, group chats now have typing indicators, not just for one-on-one anymore. Although I do believe that the person typing has to be on iOS 26 for their status to show up. Also, if you long press on a text message, you now have an option to select only part of it to copy. You no longer have to copy the entire text, although that is also an option. Next up, in the messages settings, there's a new option called Send Low Quality Photo Previews, which has actually replaced the previous option called Low Quality Image Mode. And what this is meant to do is, I guess if you send a large image, it will send a smaller version of it ahead of time to quickly get it to the other person, and then also send that large version full quality after it. So if you had Low Quality Image Mode disabled before, it might be worth revisiting and enabling this one if you want. Here's a cool improvement for Genmoji if you have a phone that supports that. You can now actually combine emojis. If you do Genmoji and type in the prompt multiple emojis, it will then create one based on all of those, and you can do more than two. Next up, this one could really come in handy, especially if you already use dual SIM. Now, if you deactivate a certain eSIM, you'll still actually be able to use it for iMessage and FaceTime and stuff. you just won't be able to send regular SMS messages through it. Next, another new feature in Messages that I actually consider really important that apparently hasn't been talked about a lot is a bunch of new message filtering options. In Messages, if you tap the menu at the top right, you'll notice that probably by default, there's going to be a new spam menu, which will by default put basically spam messages in there that it detects. And this is a new feature that I believe is on by default, and you can manage it through that same menu by going to manage filtering, and it's controlled by this toggle for filter spam. And separate from the spam filter feature is another option for screening unknown senders. This is kind of sort of like the one for calls, but a bit different. Basically, if you turn this toggle on, it seems that if you go into Messages, you're only going to see messages from people who are either contacts or you specifically mark as known on their message. And any messages from numbers that are not a contact would then show up only in the unknown senders list. Now, if you have this enabled, on top of this, if you then also go into the text message filter and then enable the text message filter option, this is a new one built into the phone where it will basically use AI to add additional categories, not just unknown senders, but you'll also see it broken down into promotions and transactions like finance, orders, and reminders. And then you also have an option to choose which of those categories will show a notification or not. I'm definitely going to keep the filter spam option on. However, personally, I'm probably going to turn off the unknown sender screening just because I would rather actually just see all texts rather than risk missing an important one that's hidden in some menu. But I think the filter spam one is a no-brainer to keep on. Next, another little feature that is on by default, I believe, in the camera settings is lens cleaning hints. So this will tell you if the back camera lens is dirty, and this might help some people that you know. All right, moving on. Another feature having to do with charging is now in the battery menu, it will show you an estimated time, not just to charge to 100%, but also 80%. Because if you didn't know, it charges to 80% a lot faster. And it will also show this information briefly if you're already plugged into charge and you wake the phone. It'll show that at the top, both of those, for a short amount of time. Next up, in the wallet app, there's a new optional feature for whether or not to have it track orders that it found in your mailboxes. It'll prompt you whether or not you want to try this feature if you go into the top right menu and then orders, or you can also enable this through the wallet settings and then order tracking and then mail beta. I believe this does require phones with Apple Intelligence, so it's not for all of them. But in any case, this could let you get notifications for orders that you didn't place through Apple Pay. For example, it showed me a notification when my Amazon order was delivered, even though that just came through email. Okay, now talking about the phone app, this one also got an optional overhaul called the Unified UI. When you first open the phone app, it may prompt you whether you want to enable it, or you can toggle between it through the top right menu. Anyway, the thing I want to focus on with this is that finally, now when you tap on an entry in that call list, it doesn't immediately dial the person, and instead, by default, it just opens the info for that call. And instead, to call someone, there's a little call button. And I like this because it was too easy to accidentally call someone if you missed tap or something. Now, in the phone settings, there is an option called tap recents to call that you can turn off if you don't like this. And another thing I'll point out is I actually prefer not the unified interface. I like the classic one, but this tap recents to call option is not there if you're using the classic interface. So you kind of have to either choose the new unified thing or the old method of accidentally tapping call numbers. Anyway, another change with the phone app is if you're making a call, there's a new more button, which opens this new overflow menu. And that's going to have some additional stuff like the add people button, which is what used to be in the position of the more button, as well as some options such as view contact card or do call recording. And I guess potentially what other apps might be able to add. Next, moving on, here are some other lesser known features in some of the other Apple apps. There's a few actually in the podcast app. For example, you can now change custom playback settings for an individual show, and it will remember that if you go to that show and then the settings menu and then go to the thing that says custom for this show. Also, during playback of a podcast, there's a playback speed thing on the left that you can now click and drag with your finger to increase or decrease the speed and with more increments than before. And also during playback, there's a new enhanced dialogue option if you want to use that. Next, in the Apple Maps app, you can now report additional incident types while you're on the road. And specifically, they added ones for heavy traffic, road work, and road closure that you can report. Next up in the music app, and I believe actually any app that plays back audio, now in the audio picker, you can actually control the audio for that particular device. So all in one place. And next, a couple things in the Files app. There's now more ways to customize the appearance of a folder if you long press on it. For example, you can customize an icon that will show on the folder. And then if you tag it with a color, the entire folder will appear as that color, whereas before it would just kind of show a dot next to it. And as for opening files, you can now long press on it and choose the default opening app for a particular file type, including a new preview app to show like a preview of that file. So that could be useful if you don't want to accidentally open a file in a whole separate app every time just to look at it. Now, definitely let me know down in the comments if I missed any good ones, and also be sure to check down there because someone might have left a comment with a good one that I didn't mention. And by the way, definitely check out my last year's iOS 18 hidden features list because basically all of those are still there. You just might not know about them. So if you want to watch that, I'll put the link right there. And of course, if you want to subscribe, I try to make videos about twice a week about different tech stuff, so it should be worth it. Anyway, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.